Hi everyone, welcome back to my next video. Today we are going to have a class from Homes on Wheels Alliance at the virtual RTR 2021. And so I think you're going to really enjoy it. And with me is Sue Ann Carlson, the Executive Director of Homes on Wheels Alliance, who did an awful lot of the work, amazing amount of work, on putting this all together. So, Sue Ann, tell us about a little bit about what's going on here.
So, from January 14th to January 21st, 2021, we have online RTR and women's RTR classes that will be offered on the Homes on Wheels Alliance YouTube channel. But what we're doing is we're taking those and doing a condensed version of them and moving them over to the Cheap RV Living YouTube channel. And that's what you're watching here.
So this is a monetized channel, but all the money that you make by watching the videos, you're gonna make me money by watching the videos, all of that money will be forwarded to, from now on and forever, will be forwarded to Homes on Wheels Alliance. So I'm not making any money on this. It will be a contribution to Homes on Wheels Alliance. Now, because this is a condensed version, there's a whole version on the Homes on Wheels Alliance YouTube channel. And if you go there, you'll see the whole thing, including questions and answers afterwards. So while this is condensed, you can see the whole thing by going to Homes on Wheels Alliance. And how will they find that?
In your YouTube channel search bar, type in Homes on Wheels Alliance, and it will come up.
So once you go to the channel or this channel, Cheap RV Living, there will be a playlist that says RTR, virtual RTR 2021. And so you can see all the classes there in order and see them all at once. So next, we're going to play the video of the class, and I hope you enjoy it and learn a lot from it. And we'll see you at the end of the video.
I'm Sue Ann Carlson. I'm the Executive Director of Homes on Wheels Alliance, also known as HOWA, H-O-W-A, the acronym. This afternoon, I'm pleased to say we're offering a class on basic solar. I'm pleased to introduce Matt. Matt and his wife, Diana, are in Vermont right now, and they've been nomads for 2.5 years in their travel trailer that they pull with the F-150 pickup truck. Matt and Diana's YouTube channel is called The Adventurous Way, and I'd highly encourage you to visit it at your pleasure. The link for that is down below in the description. So with that, Matt, the floor is yours.
So today, what I want to talk to you about with basic solar is really just that. It is the basics. I'm here to help you understand just the very basics to get you started on your journey to off-grid living with power. There's 5 main topics that I want to cover. The first thing I'd like to do is give you an introduction to RV electrical systems. From there, we're going to look at the different options to generate power. Solar is one of them, but it's not the only one. Third, we'll take a look at some of the major components of a solar system. After that, we'll talk about something called yield, which is essentially a measure of how much solar power you can expect to generate from your panels. And then finally, we're going to talk about the way to size your own system. I'm a firm believer when it comes to solar in starting small and building as you learn and as you understand what your own needs are. Now, I've shown here a motorhome, but the reality is this same diagram would work whether you have a much smaller camper or a Class B or even a travel trailer or a fifth wheel like we have. The first is what we're going to talk about as the 12-volt system. The vast majority of systems out there, of RVs, have a 12-volt system. Well, this is what powers your lights, your water pump, all those small devices and things that tend to be built into the RV. It may also power some 12-volt outlets and also some USB outlets that you may have around your RV or your trailer. The next system is the 120-volt AC system that you can see shown here with the blue arrows. These are the big devices or the residential devices, things like your air conditioning unit. If you have 120-volt plugs and outlets in your kitchen to power kettles and microwaves and instant pots and all these things. The third system in your RV, you may not think about so much, but it's your vehicle's electricity system itself. This is things like your vehicle lights that come on when you plug in the 7-pin connector on a trailer, or maybe if you're in a motorhome, it's just the chassis battery that powers the engine and the lights and things on the vehicle. a lot of people have questions like, can I run my AC on solar power? And it's kind of the wrong way to look at solar. In an RV situation, solar is typically doing one thing and one thing only, and that is putting electricity into your batteries. What you use that power for is up to you. You can use it to power your lights, you can use it with an inverter to power your 120 volt appliances, but all the solar power is ever doing is charging your batteries. There's a lot of ways you can generate power. We can talk about wind turbines and all sorts here, but for simplicity's sake, I'm just going to focus on two of them. I'd like to talk about generators and solar panels. Generators aren't inherently wrong. In some situations, they can be a really valuable addition to your RV, and they can really help out, even if you do have solar. And it's not that expensive. In fact, a generator can be cheaper than a solar system. And I know plenty of RVers who have a generator alongside their solar panels. So if a generator is so good, why would you get solar? When we're boondocking, the last thing that we want to hear is a generator from someone parked a few hundred feet away. We want to be out in nature and enjoying the peace and tranquility. If you need to lift that generator in and out of a truck bed or a storage bay or something else, that's a fairly heavy appliance that you've got to move around. Generators are not free to operate. You have to put fuel in a generator. That means, one, spending money on fuel, and two, making sure you carry fuel around with you. And lastly, generators need maintenance. If you don't stay on top of the maintenance, the generator won't keep working. I love solar. Like I said, we have never owned a generator since we hit the road. We've been almost entirely reliant on solar when we've been off grid. They're also silent, like zero noise. There's no hum, there's no buzzing from them. They are completely silent. And when we're out in nature, knowing that our rooftop solar panels are doing their job, silently keeping our batteries full, that's pretty cool. And the other great thing is they produce free power. And there is nothing more fun to me than knowing that everything that we're doing in the RV, whether it's powering our lights or charging our laptops or running an Instant Pot, we are doing it for free. But there is one little caveat here, and that's where you see the star there, which is you've got to make an investment. You have to buy the solar panels and the rest of the equipment to get started. There's also some disadvantages of solar. Solar panels take up space, and they're not actually that lightweight. Bearing in mind that these panels aren't super lightweight, you've got to factor that in to how much payload you have on your vehicle. The other thing is solar panels, as the name suggests, rely on solar, also known as the sun. So when it's cloudy, don't expect to get much solar power coming in. In summer, when you stand outside and it's hot and it's sunny, you can feel the heat. You can feel that radiation coming in from the sun, and it's really hot and it's really bright and sunny. That intensity is what the solar panels are relying on. There's a couple of other things that get us in winter. The first is that the sun is much lower in the sky. And the most important thing with solar panels is that they're pointing at the sun. The winter days tend to be a lot shorter than summer days. So not only have you got weaker sun not pointing directly at your panels, but there's fewer hours of it each day. There's three big ones that I'd like to talk about today. The solar panels themselves, solar charge controllers, and batteries. There are lots of different types of solar panels out there, but the two that I'm going to talk about today are portable solar panels and rooftop solar panels. Portable solar panels can be a really, really good addition for your RV. They're really, really easy to set up. You can buy them online, and often they're plug and play. You can buy them, connect them to your batteries, and you're good to roll. With a portable panel, you can turn that, you can tilt it, however you need to get it pointed directly at the sun. If it's hot in summer, the last place you want to park your RV is in the middle of a clearing where it's going to bake in the sun. There are a few downsides to them. The first is they can actually be really expensive. The second thing is, and I did talk a little bit about this earlier, they can be quite heavy. And think about where you're going to store it as well. It was locked to the trailer. We had a cable lock that was locking it to the trailer, and in the middle of the night, someone had come along and cut the cable and the cable lock and stolen our panel. It is much harder to steal a rooftop panel. So let's talk about why rooftop solar panels might be a good option for you. The first is they often can make good use of unused space. They're also permanently installed. So one, this is great from a theft perspective. they're not going to get stolen very easily because someone would have to climb up there and disassemble things. But they're also just not, you have to think about them. They're just always there. They're always doing their job. They also work while you're driving. Your roof is always facing the sky. And as you're driving down the road, all that power is coming in and charging your batteries. Some of the challenges with rooftop solar panels, they require installation. It is RV specific. You need to install a system on the roof that allows your panels to be raised on one side, and then you have to think about which way you're going to park the RV. Rooftop panels mean your RV has to be in direct sun. The next big component in your solar system is the charge controller, and there are two types of solar charge controller. Your solar panel has wires coming out of it that are producing electricity, but it's not quite the right type of electricity, if you like, to go straight into your batteries. The voltage often needs adjusting to charge your batteries at the right rate. There are two types of solar charge controller that we're going to discuss today. PWM, which stands for pulse width modulation, and MPPT, which is maximum power point tracking. PWM are the simple charger. They're straightforward, they're durable, it's easy to find waterproof ones. They're also pretty cheap. This one here that I've got, I think this was a 30 amp PWM solar charge controller. So this would be good for about 300 to 400 watts of solar. The downside is they're not that efficient. You lose about 25% of all the power from your solar panels before it ever makes it to your batteries. The other type of solar charge controller are the MPPT solar charge controllers. These are way more efficient. We're talking about 95 to even 99% efficient. So you may have heard about having 12 volt or 24 volt panels and making sure you match them correctly to your batteries. That's really important with a PWM controller. You need to make sure that if you have a 12 volt battery, you have a 12 volt compatible solar panel. And that's because the PWM controller can't do anything fancy with the solar panel, but an MPPT controller can. There are some problems though. These are expensive. Not just more expensive, but look how big and heavy they are. Now, the third component I'm going to talk about today is batteries. Two types I'm going to consider are lead acid, and I'm kind of lumping together flooded lead acid and AGM in that bucket there. And the other one is lithium. Lead acid batteries are great if you're just starting out on your journey. They're cheap to buy. There are some big problems, though, with lead acid batteries for solar. They don't charge very effectively all the way up. So if your batteries won't accept all that power, you're wasting that sunlight. Lithium batteries don't have that problem. They bulk charge all the way up to essentially full. As part of the presentation today, we've got a special free downloadable PDF on our website. You can find it at adventurousway.com/RTR. And in that, I've done a full comparison of the different types of RV batteries. Next up, I'd like to talk about solar yield. If I have 500 watts of solar panels, how much will I really get out of it? The big takeaway here, though, is that if you've got 500 watts of solar, for example, you're only really going to see that on the very sunniest days in good conditions in summer. In other words, if you have a 100 watt panel that's not tilted in winter, the best you will see at lunchtime on the sunniest day of winter is about 40 watts. But what a lot of people find is they have to size their system for winter. And in summer, they're flush with power. They've got more energy than they can use. So with that, I want to give you some basic tips that we've learned through experience to help you maximize your solar yield. The first one is a fairly obvious one. You want to make sure that you can park if you've got roof mounted panels or position them on the floor so that they're facing south. Secondly, in winter especially, try and tilt your panels if you can. Another thing with portable panels is during the day, go and turn it round so it's always facing the sun as the sun moves across the sky. The last one here about avoiding shade is a really important one. Any amount of shade is a big problem for a solar panel. Even a tiny twig or a branch that's just making a tiny little bit of shade on the panel will essentially wipe out the entire panel. So in this section, I want to talk about how you go about sizing your system. Broken things down into three big categories of stuff: low, medium, and high power devices. The first is low power devices. These are typically small handheld things or portable things, phones, tablets, cameras. If you're running things that are mainly in this category, maybe a portable panel or two is all you need to keep yourself charged off grid. The next step up from this is the medium power devices. you need to get 120 volt AC power to them. So you often need an inverter to run these. The last category of stuff, predictably, is the high power devices. These exclusively run on AC power, 120 volt AC power. If you have things in this category, you need a big solar system to offset the needs that they have. To use these properly off-grid, you're talking probably a 1500 watt solar system or more to charge your batteries up each day. So the last thing I want to talk about in this section is an electrical audit. An electrical audit is a way of saying, how much power do I really need? You need to add up the power that all of your devices use. One of my favorite ways to do it, just because it's quick and easy, is go to an RV park and plug in and make sure the RV park has a meter on the electricity, has an electricity meter on the shore power plug. And using that, you can then see exactly how much power you used overnight. You can use something like this. This is called a kilowatt. You plug this into your outlet and you plug your appliance into this, and it'll tell you exactly how much power you're using. The third way is to look at the device. They'll often say on them exactly how much power they draw. Sometimes this will be expressed as volts and amps, and just multiplying those two together will tell you the total. But by far the best way to do this is to use a battery monitor and a shunt. Once you know how much power you need on a daily basis, that's your guide to deciding how much solar power you're going to have to add to your RV. But just remember, you can start small and build up. Wherever you go on your solar journey, just always remember that nothing is set in stone. You can always tweak things and change things and learn as you go. Just as a reminder, if you haven't done already, check out our website at adventurousway.com/RTR, where we have that free downloadable RV battery comparison guide that will help you on your journey to choosing the right type of battery to go along with your solar system.
That was some very good teaching. I think you got a lot out of it. But this was a condensed version. So to see the entire thing, including questions and answers, where do they need to go?
You can go to the Homes on Wheels Alliance YouTube channel. In your search bar, just type in Homes on Wheels Alliance and it'll come up.
And once there, there'll be a playlist there of all the RTR videos in their entire length. So there'll be a lot more info there than this condensed version. Well, I hope you got something out of this video. If you did, like us on YouTube, subscribe to the channel, hit that thumbs up button, and we'll talk to you later.